Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 28th May 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and the page numbers in Chennai, Delhi, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles are provided in the description box. For the benefit of mobile phone viewers, the timestamping is also provided in the comment section. Now let us go to the first article of the day. Now this article is relevant in prelim syllabus under rights issues and in your main syllabus in GS paper 1 under role of women, their problems and remedies. The article is based on global and regional estimates of violence against women, the prevalence and health effects of intimate partner violence and non-partner sexual violence, which was released by World Health Organization. Now this estimate report states that sexual violence profoundly affect the short-term and long-term physical and mental health of women. See, intimate partner violence is a major contributor to women's mental health problems, sexual and reproductive health problems, and maternal and neonatal health problems. See, when we say mental health of women is affected, it means that this violence by the so-called intimate partner can lead to, you know, post-traumatic stress disorder, anxiety disorders, depression, eating disorders, and also suicidality. When we say sexual and reproductive health problems, we mean lack of autonomy of women in going for pregnancy or abortion, gynecological problems, possibility of getting infected by HIV and other sexually transmitting infections. See, the problems that are maternal or neonatal health-related problems that include low birth weight for a child given birth by the woman, prematurity and associated problems, and also loss of pregnancy. See, these mental health problems can ultimately lead to disability and death. Not only mental health problems, physical health problems related to physical health, and also reproductive and sexual health, and also maternal health. All these things can ultimately lead to disability and death. Now, coming to intimate partner violence, we need to know who is an intimate partner. Now, the World Health Organization in the estimate report says, intimate partner can be a person in a formal relationship such as a marriage, or an informal relationship such as dating relationships and unmarried sexual relationships also. So when we mean violence by an intimate partner, we mean the acts of physical violence in itself or sexual violence in itself or both. When we say physical violence, it includes slapping, throwing something that could hurt the partner, intense pushing, which is also called as shoving, or being kicked or dragging or beating and being choked or burnt on purpose, and threatening the partner with a gun or knife or any other weapon. By saying sexual violence, we actually mean physically forcing the partner to have sexual intercourse when the partner is not willing. It also includes having sexual intercourse because one partner is afraid of what the other partner might do if he or she does not have the intercourse with the partner. And it also includes forcing to do something sexual that the partner finds humiliating or degrading treatment. Now, according to WHO or the World Health Organization, this prevalence of violence by intimate partner is highest in the southeastern region, which according to WHO includes India, Bangladesh, East Timor, Myanmar, Sri Lanka and Thailand. One should read carefully the article title. See, it doesn't say India. In India, women face most violence by the partner in the world. It says India is among the countries where women face most violence by the partner. See, the lifetime prevalence of physical and sexual intimate partner violence among women in this region is around 37.7%. It could be physical or sexual intimate partner violence or sexual violence or both. And it is in this region, India is also a part. Now, this means around 37.7% of women partners have suffered physical or sexual violence from their male partner in these regions where India is also a part. Now, the article states that among men, the offenders could be, you know, those having low education. Because when they have low education, they do not know about the signs of body of women, the menstrual and reproductive health of women, the human rights and others. And we even find educated men, you know, sometimes versed in such behavior, and they are incorrigibles. Also, those who have faced bad treatment in childhood may have such violent behavior. See, that is why they say any child should not be abused or treated badly. These maltreatment or the bad treatment could result in offending behavior in the adulthood. Those who are studying psychology could be well versed in the after effects of this maltreatment of children. Now, coming to exposure to domestic violence against their mothers. Now, this means that the male child is seeing his father beating his mother or his father using abusive words against his mother. Gradually, because of the close contact within the family setup and in the absence of positive guidance, the male child will also become, male child has possibility to become one like his own father. In some cases, we can see the male children threatening their mother in the same way how their father would treat them. Imagine how these male children would treat their women friends and intimate partners. Horrible. Now, studies have found that male members who use alcohol harmfully, or the harmful use of alcohol, are also perpetrators of physical and sexual violence. Now, the presence of unequal gender norms, particularly in patriarchal societies, and attitudes accepting violence as a normal behavior, these also have profound influence in the violent behavior with the spouse or the intimate partner. And finally, the sense of entitlement, in other words, treating partner just as a property in case of physical violence and just as a sexual property in case of sexual violence, that can be, who can be misused or abused according to their own whims and fancies. Now, it is this part of taking undue advantage over the body of the female partner leading to sexual violence. Now, it is found that potential victims of women are those having low education, because when they have low education, they may not know how to respond, how to file a complaint, or how to apply for divorce, who to reach for help, or how to communicate insecurities and other things as well. Now, exposure to mothers being abused by father. See, there are two things. In the presence of good and positive guidance, this helps female children to take actions against the father, while in the absence of guidance, the children think this is fate and it is pitiful that they are born as women. Abuse during childhood has indirect correlations to acceptance of violence. If women have the attitude of accepting the stupid male privilege, be it physically, economically, or in works, or in whatever way they are, this makes these women a potential victim of physical and sexual violence at the hands of the male partners. If a woman accepts that women are subordinate to men, now that is extremely dangerous, because such women take the blame irrationally on themselves when such violence happens to them. This article states that advocacy counseling and empowerment counseling interventions are required, and they are proven method of assistance and prevention of future violence. Also, there has to be counseling by home visitation, because only then we could easily identify such violence are happening and could possibly feasibly assist the victims with special care and attention. Now, with respect to India, if you ask whether India recognized the forced sexual assault committed by a husband as an offense or an intimate partner as an offense, the answer is yes, but ridiculously. How? Now, see, Section 375 gives such protection for married female partners. But we say ridiculous because to file complaint of marital rape or assault by intimate partner violence, here we are talking about sexual violence, then the woman partner has to suffer before attaining 15 years of age. Thus, it is very clear that it neglects all the women who are 15 years old and above. See, even after more than 70 years of independence, women in this age category are neglected by the lawmaking body of India, that is the parliament. Now, that is also one of the reason why we say there has to be better representation of women in legislatures, because they will bring policy for better policy for women and children. Very recently, we have seen one article discussion in our previous classes. Now, a change in this section 375 has to take place to accept legally that an act of love between husband and wife to be based on respect, equality, with care and consent, and with clear communication. Now, very recently, World Health Organization has released a framework titled as Respect Women, Preventing Violence Against Women, wherein this author and also the particular framework and even the organization itself, World Health Organization, asks this framework should be widely adopted by all the stakeholders, particularly the primary audience for this document, Respect Women, are the policymakers, to inculcate various points that are available in the framework in adopting a policy for the nation and region wise. Now, the displayed mains question will be discussed in the revision and practice session, or the final session of today. Now, let us move on to the next news article. Now, the next article is about inviting the leaders of member states from BIMSTEC for the swearing in ceremony of Prime Minister, that is scheduled or likely to take place on May 30th. And this article will be relevant in prelim syllabus under national importance and international importance, and in physical and economic geography of the world. It can be linked to main syllabus in GS paper 2 under the area India and its neighborhood relations and bilateral regional groupings and agreements involving India and affecting India's interests. And next in effect of policies and politics of developing countries on India's interests, and finally also in important international institutions, agencies and fora and their structure and mandate. Now, as already stated, see, the leaders of the member states of BIMSTEC have been invited for the swearing-in ceremony of the Prime Minister. Also, the member states of Shanghai Cooperation Organization, the leaders of the BIMSTEC member states are invited because of the government's focus on neighborhood first policy. The President of Kyrgyz Republic, Prime Minister of Mauritius, President of Bangladesh, Prime Minister of Nepal and Bhutan are also invited to the ceremony. And one fact with respect to Shanghai Cooperation Organization, see that Kyrgyzstan is the current chair of this organization. Now, in 2014, at that time, for the swearing-in ceremony of the Prime Minister, leaders of SAARC countries were invited, but this time it was still not clear whether all members of SAARC countries will be invited or not. The article specifically talks about leaders of Shanghai Cooperation Organization and BIMSTEC member states. Now, we have already covered Shanghai Cooperation Organization in our 23rd May newspaper analysis. The link has been provided in the description. Now let us have our focus on BIMSTEC. See, it's a short form or an acronym for the Bay of Bengal Initiative for Multi-Sectoral Technical and Economic Cooperation. Now, it came into existence on 6th June of 1997 through Bangkok Declaration. It is a regional organization that has seven member countries that lie in the littoral and adjacent areas of the Bay of Bengal, and it constitutes a contiguous regional unity. See, we frequently see the word littoral. See, it means a region lying along the shore. So in the context of BIMSTEC, it is the region or countries lying along the shore of Bay of Bengal. So if you see this map, see, the seven member states include five from South Asia: Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal, Sri Lanka, and two countries from Southeast Asia, including Myanmar and Thailand. Now, today we saw with respect to this WHO on our first article, India as part of Southeast Asia. See, that is how the World Health Organization has categorically placed India in the group of Southeast Asia. Now, generally, when we say India is part of South Asia, so you need not confuse between the two. Now, remember this map, as countries are nearby India only, so it won't be much difficult to, you know, keep it in mind. Now, you can have these things in by another method, because or a more comprehensive method, because initially the economic bloc was formed with only 4 member states. At that time, the acronym was BISTEC, where B stands for Bangladesh, I stands for India, S stands for Sri Lanka, and T stands for Thailand. Then EC stands for Economic Cooperation. In the very first year, 1997 itself, in the month of December, Myanmar was included. So therefore, the group was renamed as BIMSTEC, where M stood for Myanmar. But if you use this method as a method to remember, you should not forget that Nepal and Bhutan are also members of this BIMSTEC. Because in 2004 only, Nepal and Bhutan were included. The acronym BIMSTEC was not changed after 2004. But only the full form was changed to Bay of Bengal Initiative for Multi-Sectoral Technical and Economic Cooperation from Bangladesh, India, Myanmar, Sri Lanka, Thailand Economic Cooperation. Idea of BIMSTEC was conceived as a sub-regional forum bringing South Asia and Southeast Asia regions closer. Also, the forum provides a very good position for India's Act East policy. See, one of the prime purpose of India's Act East policy is with respect to connectivity and development process in northeastern region. And this forum is giving a distinct orientation to this India's Act East policy. That means it is a very significant pathway that provides the process or the development process or the connectivity of the northeastern region of India. The forum has also established a platform for intra-regional cooperation between SAARC and ASEAN members. We are discussing about BIMSTEC, and there is a platform for intra-regional cooperation between SAARC and ASEAN members. You can see around 150 crore people in this BIMSTEC region that constitutes almost around 22% of global population. They say that the combined GDP is around 2.7 trillion. And therefore, the region also commands a significant proportion of combined gross domestic product also. In the last 5 years, BIMSTEC member states have been able to sustain an average 6.5% economic growth despite the global financial meltdown. See, the objective of building such an alliance was to harness shared and accelerated growth through mutual cooperation. Now, in areas of common interests of the member states, you know, particularly to reduce the damaging impacts of globalization and also by utilizing the regional resources and the specific geographical advantages for the countries in this BIMSTEC. Now, unlike several other regional groupings, now this BIMSTEC is a sector-driven cooperation organization. In the year 1997, there were 6 sectors for sectoral cooperation. That time it was trade, technology, energy, transport, tourism, and fisheries. And in 2008, they expanded it with 9 more sectors. Agriculture, public health, poverty alleviation, counter-terrorism, environment, culture, people-to-people contact, and climate change. And these are some of the areas of concerns of these particular countries in this BIMSTEC. Now, the chairmanship with respect to BIMSTEC, now this rotates among the member states. The present chair is Sri Lanka. India was the chair in 2000 and then the period 2006 to 2008. One thing to note, the permanent secretariat of BIMSTEC is established in the capital of Bangladesh, that is Dhaka. Now, what is the highest policy making body with respect to BIMSTEC? It is the summits. The BIMSTEC summit is the highest policy making body. The summit is held every 2 years. The first meeting was held in Bangkok, Thailand. Second summit was held in our country in New Delhi in November 2008. The third summit was held in the capital of Myanmar, that is Nay Pyi Taw, in 2014. Very recently, last year, the fourth summit was held in Kathmandu, Nepal. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Now let us move on to next news article. Now we shall discuss about rhinoceros. See, these two news articles have appeared in the same page. First is the picture that has appeared in the last page in all editions. Now it mentions about greater one-horned rhinoceros in Pobitora Wildlife Sanctuary. Now in the same page, there is another news article about Sumatran rhino, which tells that the last male Sumatran rhino of Malaysia has died. So we shall see about this one-horned rhinoceros and other species of rhinos that exist in the world. We shall also see some facts about Pobitora Wildlife Sanctuary. Now, these articles will be relevant in prelims syllabus under current events of national importance and international importance, and in general issues on environmental ecology, biodiversity. Now, in main syllabus, under GS Paper 3, it will be relevant in the area conservation. Now, coming to rhinoceros species of India, see, its scientific name is Rhinoceros unicornis. Now, unicornis means single horn. The common name is greater one-horned rhinoceros. Now, see, if you see the rhinoceros, if you observe, its skin is brownish gray in color, and it will be very thick, similar to armor plate. Now, if you consider different rhino species that lives in Asia, this one-horned rhino species is the largest in size, and therefore it is called as greater one-horned rhinoceros. Now, if you see the geographical spread, this species is spread across India, Nepal and Bhutan. And you can see more number of greater one-horned rhinoceros in the state of Assam. Now, know that the greater one-horned rhinoceros is the state animal of Assam. This species is listed under Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. And it has also been mentioned in Appendix 1 of the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora. Here, Appendix 1 lists those species that are most endangered among the sites listed animals and plants. Now, they are threatened with extinction, and sites prohibits international trade in specimens of these species except when the purpose of the import is non-commercial. For instance, like scientific research. Now, even in these exceptional cases, trade may take place provided it is authorized by granting of both import permit and export permit. Now, let us see about different rhino species that exist in the world. See, there are only 5 species of rhinos present in the world. Now, they are found only in continents of Asia and Africa. Now, the names of 5 species, their classification in IUCN Red List of Threatened Species, and their location we are going to see here. First, Sumatran rhino, which we saw in the news. It is listed as critically endangered in IUCN Red List of Threatened Species. Now, you note that Sumatra is an island in the country Indonesia. Now, this species is found only in Asian continent, especially in Southeast Asia. Now, we can find these rhinos in the countries of Malaysia and Indonesia in its wildlife habitat. Next, let's see about this black rhino. Again, it is also listed as critically endangered in IUCN Red List. Now, these are found only in African continent, especially in Southern African continent. Now, white rhino, it is listed as near threatened in the IUCN Red List. They are also found only in African continent. Then, Javan rhino, listed as critically endangered in IUCN Red List. It is endemic to Java Island of Indonesia, and therefore the name Javan rhino. Only about 50 to 60 rhinoceros of this species are present currently. Now, let's see this one-horned rhinoceros. See, it is listed as vulnerable in IUCN Red List. And if you see the geographical extent or the spread of this species, it is located in Asian continent in India, Nepal and Bhutan. Now, see the threats, common threats faced by different rhino species is particularly the threats of habitat loss and poaching. Poaching for the illegal trade in rhino horn remains a biggest threat to the one-horned rhino, great one-horned rhino. Now, the horn is valued in North Africa and the Middle East as an ornamental dagger handle, although there is no scientific proof of its medical value. See, the horn is used in traditional Asian medicines, primarily for the treatment of a variety of ailments, including epilepsy, fevers, and cancer. Now, we could see extensive illegal trade persisting throughout Asia, despite the protections and bans on international trade of rhino horn. Now, the next threat is natural disasters, particularly flooding. Also, these Javan rhinos that are endemic to Java Islands of Indonesia face a major threat of extinction due to diseases anytime. We saw they are only around 50 to 60 present in these Java Islands. Now, let us see about this Pobitora Wildlife Sanctuary. See, as stated in news article, this sanctuary has the highest density of rhinos in the world. We could see 102 rhino species living in a 38.8 square kilometer area. And it is also having the second highest concentration, that is the second highest population of rhinos in the state of Assam after Kaziranga National Park. Now, the sanctuary is located in Marigaon district of Assam in the floodplains of Brahmaputra River. Now, some of the significant fauna or animals that you can find in this wildlife sanctuary, you know, like fishing cat, feral buffaloes, Chinese pangolins, and pheasant tailed jacana. This is a bird. So we have Indian Rhino Vision 2020, and this program or this vision was launched in the year 2005 by Assam Forest Department in partnership with World Wild Fund India and International Rhino Foundation and US Fish and Wildlife Service. The program aims at increasing the number and range of rhinos in Assam through wild-to-wild translocations from Kaziranga National Park and Pobitora Wildlife Sanctuary to potential protected areas that includes Manas National Park, Burachapori Wildlife Sanctuary, Lakhowa Wildlife Sanctuary and Dibru Saikova National Park. That is from Kaziranga National Park and Pobitora Wildlife Sanctuary to Manas National Park, Lakhowa Wildlife Sanctuary, Dibru Saikova National Park. The vision is to attain a population of 3,000 wild rhinos in the state of Assam, distributed over some 7 of its protected areas by the year 2020, next year. Now, that's about this Indian Rhino Vision 2020. We will see more updates with respect to rhino in the coming days news articles. Now, the displayed practice prelims question will be discussed in the last session. Now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. Now this news article discusses about burnout, which is a medical condition that was newly declared by World Health Organization. Now this article is relevant in prelim syllabus under current events of international importance and in general science. Now World Health Organization has recognized burnout as a medical condition in its international classification of diseases. Now see, ICD, International Classification of Diseases, is a global standard for diagnostic health information. Now it is maintained by WHO. It's basically a catalog or a book that contains the list of diseases, disorders, injuries and other health related concerns. Now it acts as a benchmark for diagnosing, you know, for the purpose of health service providers. It also acts as a benchmark for the health insurers as well. See, even mental health providers for diagnosis, they look at this ICD, particularly with respect to disorders. Now, the news article, it is mentioned as ICD-11. See, 11 means 11th revision of ICD. This ICD-11 has been released yesterday and will come into effect from 1st January 2022. Wherein in this ICD-11, WHO has included burnout as a medical condition for the first time. See, when you say burnout, it is a syndrome that results from chronic workplace stress that has not been successfully managed. Chronic means everyday workplace stress. Simple terms, it's a syndrome that occurs because of the continuous everyday stress that an individual cannot manage in a workplace. See, syndrome means a group of symptoms that consistently occur together, or it can also be defined as, you know, characteristic combination of opinions, emotions or even behavior. World Health Organization has explained that this burnout syndrome is characterized by three dimensions. First is the feelings of energy depletion or energy exhaustion. It's a condition where an individual always has the opinion of feeling tired always. Now then you see increased mental distance from one's job. See, it's a feeling of negativism or cynicism related to the job. Simply means a person does not find any purpose in doing his or her routine job. Therefore, he or she gets a feeling of negativity. Now cynicism means a fixed mindset that a person always thinks that the job he or she is working is useless. The third is reduced professional efficacy. Now this is a result of this feelings of energy depletion, and also by the negativism, the distance, mental distance that one has with respect to the particular job. And when there is no motivation to work, the ability to produce a desired result will be less, will gradually reduce. That means there is a reduced professional efficacy. So all these dimensions will convey that a person is experiencing a burnout. Now, in this ICD-11, WHO has also added or modified some health conditions. Let us see that. See, for the first time, WHO has recognized video gaming as an addiction. It was listed along with gambling and cocaine, drugs such as cocaine. Now, World Health Organization has also classified compulsive sexual behavior as a mental disorder. Now, compulsive sexual behavior means when a person has major focus in his life, in such as masturbation or having multiple sexual partners or depending on online, particularly pornography, for sexual gratification. And all these things, rather than focusing on career, health and relationship, see, these are difficult to control and could damage relationships, career and even health and entire life also. Therefore, World Health Organization have classified the compulsive sexual behavior as a mental disorder. And one good thing with respect to the revision is that ICD-11 has removed transgenderism from its list of mental disorders. And now it has listed it under the chapter on conditions related to sexual health. Now, the displayed practice prelims question will be discussed in the final session. Now, let us move on to next news article. Now, this article is about Mount Everest. See, this article will be relevant in prelims under current events of national and international importance and world physical geography and also general science. Mount Everest is the tallest peak in the world, with a height or altitude of 8,848 meters. See, it is located in Nepal-China border. This peak is part of Greater Himalayas, which was also called as Himadri. The peak was located by George Everest in the year 1841. Therefore, it is named as Mount Everest. But it is called by different names in both Nepal and China. See, it is called as Sagarmatha in Nepal and as Chomlungma in China. It's very famous for mountain climbers. Every mountaineer in the world aims to climb this peak at least once in their lifetime. And while climbing, these mountaineers are accompanied by Sherpas. Now, let's see about this Sherpas. See, Sherpas are ethnic groups who are native to Greater Himalayas or this Himadri. They live in Nepal, surrounding the mountain region of this peak. They generally live at higher altitudes, so they are masters in mountain climbing naturally. And these Sherpas act as guides and porters to the mountaineers who wish to climb Mount Everest. Now, there are two ways to climb Mount Everest. One is from the side of Nepal, other is from the side of China. Many mountaineers prefer the side of Nepal because it is cheaper to get a climbing permit. And Nepal also earns a lot of money by issuing this climbing permits, because it is said that each climbing permit cost around $11,000. And the news mentioned in the article is that at least 10 climbers have passed away or died, or gone missing in this climbing season, which includes 4 Indians. The main reason given in this article is that there is heavy traffic in climbing the last peak. Usually, spring season is the perfect time to climb Mount Everest, since the weather will support this climbing. But due to bad weather in the past few months, this has pushed the mountaineers to climb the last peak of Mount Everest within a very narrow time frame. See, everyone cannot reach the peak at the same time. A long queue is waiting on the path for the last peak. Temperatures are usually sub-zero at such higher altitudes, and waiting in these sub-zero temperatures at such higher altitudes can be fatal or deathly to the mountaineers. And the deaths in this year were mostly due to frostbite, exhaustion, dehydration, and lack of oxygen. When you say frostbite, it means injury caused to the tissues of human body, such as nose, fingers, or toes, due to the extreme cold temperature. And exhaustion means tiredness, dehydration is nothing but loss of body fluids. And since the last summit or the last peak of Mount Everest is close to 8,000 meters, the availability of oxygen will be low. Now, in a long waiting time, the available resources such as water, oxygen, and food are likely to reduce or get over. Now, all these factors lead to extreme unhealthy conditions and finally leads to death of the individual. Now, one another reason cited in the editorial is that excess permits issued by Nepal. See, Nepal awarded 381 permits for this spring season, where each climbing permit costs around, as already seen, $11,000. And many prefer climbing the Nepal side because of the cheaper prices of permit, while it is more costly to climb from the Tibet side. And some suggestions, the author says, you know, like the concerned authorities must learn from the present tragedy. And Nepal has to restrict the number of permits that it provides every season. And also the safety measures for the climbers have to be ensured by the authorities. Now, these are very common suggestions, and one need not be, you know, master enough to provide all these suggestions. Whenever you write examination, when you find such things, you have a general understanding, even you can provide such suggestions. Now, the first question is with respect to BIMSTEC. They're asking which among the following countries are member states of BIMSTEC organization: Sri Lanka, Afghanistan, India, Bangladesh, Pakistan. See, in our today's discussion, we saw a trick to remember member states of BIMSTEC. B for Bangladesh, I for India, M for Myanmar, S for Sri Lanka, and T for Thailand. EC stands for Economic Cooperation. Note that it also includes two other countries, Bhutan and Nepal. So from this, we can say option that is 1, 3 and 4 are option B, that is 1, 3 and 4 are correct. If you carefully observe this question, see, all the countries given in the options are SAARC nations. So if the question would have asked for SAARC nations, then the option D, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 would have been the correct answer for this question. And note that there are 8 member countries in SAARC. And the 5 countries given in this question, and also Maldives, Bhutan and Nepal. One another thing is that you can easily eliminate Pakistan and Afghanistan because they are no way littoral states of Bay of Bengal. So easily we can say that Sri Lanka, India and Bangladesh are member states of BIMSTEC organization. Now the second question, this protected area has the highest density of rhinoceros species in the world. This protected area is also part of Indian Rhino Vision 2020, from where translocation of rhinos is being carried out. Which of the following area best suits the above description? And they have carefully given confusing options. And we saw that Pobitora Wildlife Sanctuary has the highest density of rhinoceros species in the world. And based on this Indian Rhino Vision 2020, from this Pobitora Wildlife Sanctuary and from Kaziranga National Park, rhinos are being translocated to various protected areas such as Manas, Dibru-Saikova National Park, etc. So the correct answer for this question is option D, Pobitora Wildlife Sanctuary. Now the next question, ICD is a medical catalog of diseases, disorders, injuries and other health related concerns, and it is maintained by World Health Organization. The 11th revision of ICD has listed which of the following medical conditions for the first time: video gaming, compulsive sexual behavior, burnout. Today, while discussing the article related to burnout, we saw that video gaming, compulsive sexual behavior and also burnout were included for the first time in the ICD classification. So the correct answer for this question is option D, 1, 2 and 3. Now next we are going to see one mains question in GS1. Intimate partner violence has become a cause of concern for not only the health of women at risk, but also their rights. In this context, what is meant by IPV and suggest measures to address the menace? Now for this question, you have to first state few points to support the statement given in the question. And here you can include the points discussed today, whatever you could substantiate, you know, the meaning of the statement. See, while highlighting using the WHO estimates, you may say that intimate partner violence on one side affects the health of women. We saw that it could even lead to disability and death here, even suicide, sometimes homicides also. More than 30% of the women killed are killed by husbands, the report says. And on the other side, you should also say that this amounts to serious violation of human rights. It is violation of right to autonomy. Physical and sexual violence, particularly here, violence by the partner, both physical violence and sexual violence, amounts to violation of human rights, violation of right to autonomy, violation of human dignity, violation of respect, all these things. So then you define this intimate partner violence based on physical and sexual violence and suggest measures to improve the situation. Today we saw two important things with respect to improving the situation: advocacy counseling and empowerment counseling, and also counseling by visiting the homes, you know, to understand the extent of the problem and thereby addressing them with appropriate, with respect to specific care to be given to the victims. And also you can highlight that amendment has to be carried out in IPC section 375 to recognize this marital rape, or you know, marital sexual violence, or this intimate partner violence as a offense, and to give protection to the victimized women. With this, we come to the end of this analysis for today. And if you liked the video, press the like button, share, comment and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for daily updates with respect to the newspaper analysis.